Hi, my name is Kate Timms, and I'm a scientific content writer at Izon Science, and today I'm going to be talking to you about types of extracellular vesicles. Back when I started my PhD on extracellular vesicles in 2014, it was common to refer to all small extracellular vesicles as exosomes. We simply didn't really know better as a field. Even when I submitted my thesis, the markers I used and the morphology I showed using electron microscopy were thought to be characteristic of exosomes, rather than EVs in general. At that point though, the field was starting to get significantly more cautious about the use of the term exosome, and I was quizzed about the identity of my EVs in my viva. Fast forward to 2022, when my PhD research was finally published, I wouldn't have dreamed of calling the extracellular vesicles I had studied exosomes, despite referring to them as that at the time. And I had mass spectrometry showing that at least some of the vesicles were enriched for endosomal proteins. So why the change? Why did I almost cringe at saying the word exosome? Well, change is essential in science. The very foundation that modern science is built upon dictates that we must be malleable to changing our hypotheses and what we think we know about the world based upon newly revealed knowledge. The field of extracellular vesicles is, or at least is generally trying to, do just that. As with every burgeoning field, things seemed complex but relatively simple at first. EVs were divided into three categories back then. The smallest were exosomes, the middle-sized were microvesicles, and the largest were apoptotic bodies. That's the diagram I drew for my PhD thesis, but it simply isn't the full story. As we dug deeper into these fascinating vesicles, we found more and more variation, more subtypes, and less certainty. Now we know that the number of EV subtypes is up there in the dozens, perhaps even higher. This schematic shows a more complex version of affairs than I reported in my PhD thesis. The old favourites are still there. You can see exosomes forming as intraluminal vesicles in late endosomes, turning them into multivesicular bodies, which can then fuse with the plasma membrane to release their cargo, now called exosomes. Microvesicles are present too, budding from the plasma membrane, though now we show this range of sizes as overlapping with that of exosomes, as well as larger vesicles. Cancer cell microvesicles are now known as oncosomes, and are perhaps even larger. Apoptotic bodies are still there too, though there is more variation in apoptotic cell-derived EVs than we previously thought. There are also microsomes, left behind by migrating cells, and the secretory autophagosomes, which may contain whole organelles. Finally, there are cell-type-specific EVs, such as syncytial knots, which are nuclei-filled vesicles which pinch off from the placental syncytia trophoblast. And those are just the ones we could fit into this diagram. There are likely many more EV subtypes yet to be discovered. With so many types of EVs, you may think that there would be a plethora of markers to tell them apart. Unfortunately, that isn't the case. Evidence from the literature is conclusive. Truly specific EV markers likely don't exist, and this isn't without effort from the field. A marker of exosomes is somewhat of a holy grail, yet every promising candidate so far has eventually been discounted. The endosomal sorting complexes required for transport, or escort proteins, were long thought to be specific to exosomes, especially given that their name implied that they were endosomal. However, it turns out that escort complexes 1, 2, and 3 are all involved with the budding of microvesicles at the surface, discounting them, including the long-tailed exosome marker TSU101, from being exosome-specific. The same is true for syntenin-1 and Alex, both of which are present in EVs of different subtypes. However, the escort-0 complex may be endosome-specific, making its components potential markers of exosomes. Indeed, knocking down two of the escort-0 proteins reduce the release of CD63-positive small EVs. And CD63 is exosomal, right? Wrong, unfortunately, at least according to a recent study. Tetraspanins like CD9, CD821, and CD63 were long touted as exosome markers, but they have been found to also be present in other EV subtypes. CD63-positive EVs, which also carry CD9, are likely membrane-budding, and are therefore microvesicles. However, it has also recently been reported that EVs which are CD63 positive but CD9 negative may indeed be exosomes. But how can you be sure that that is true for every EV matching those criteria? cognitive membrane budding vesicle positive for CD63 just by chance miss out on grabbing its own CD9 molecule at the plasma membrane and so unwittingly masquerade as an exosome? Given the ambiguity here, CD63 is not a very attractive exosome marker. Using a negative marker in CD9 is not attractive either. After all, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. However, all may not be lost. LAMP proteins may hold the answer. LAMP proteins are used as markers of the lysosome and certain endosomes, making them an attractive candidate for an exosome marker, especially as they were found to be substantially enriched in CD63 positive EVs as compared to CD9 positive EVs. Even so, we would be cautious to call anything a true exosome marker. Even our current understanding tells us that EVs are more complex than that, and there are probably no hard and fast rules, especially between different cell types. At least for now, an exosome's biogenesis needs to be seen to be believed. But what about tools to study exosomes? GW4869 is an inhibitor of the neutral sphingomyelinase, which is thought to be required for the ceramide-dependent budding of intraluminal vesicles. This has led to it being billed as an exosome inhibitor. However, a recent study showed that GW4869 has little to no effect on the secretion of CD63 positive and CD9 negative EVs, which are likely exosomes. This led to the authors of this study to warn caution when using GW4869. What does all this uncertainty mean for the EV field? Well, for starters, it suggests that using the umbrella term extracellular vesicles is likely the safest and most accurate way to describe your vesicles. Exosome may be a great word that the people outside of the field recognize, but using it in your manuscript title or abstract doesn't actually get you any more citations, despite the prevailing wisdom that the term garners more attention. Secondly, it means that we should all be a bit more cautious when choosing markers and tools to study our vesicles. More research is needed to further characterize EV subsets. Tunable resistive pulse sensing, such as the exoid, is a great place to start. With the exoid, you can measure each vesicle individually in your heterogeneous EV sample, allowing you to visualize subtypes of EVs by their size and charge. Here at Izon Science, we can help you in starting your journey to understand the true complexity of your EV samples, from rapid and efficient isolation through to characterization.